Well, I can give many reasons, and I don't know which one is the right one. So working in the factory at that time was not easy. It was in the 50s. And I left the medical school because I didn't feel that I would be a good doctor, and this is a much more responsible profession than being a mathematician. So there you cannot make mistake. Here we make mistake all the time. And how I became mathematician, it's not so complicated story. In the high school, I was not a good mathematician, but my friend, whom I very much admired because he was much taller than me, and I always had this problem that I was short. So actually I started to grow when I was already more than 17 years old, because until then I was 150, which is dwarf. So therefore I very much admired the high guy. And he also was the best, by far the best mathematician in the class. And I could do the exercises and I got the good mark in the class, but nothing special. And because I mainly studied biology. So I went to medical school, and then as you mentioned, factory. And then after that, by chance, I met him. And that is a strange story, or maybe not so strange, that I met him when I went into the town, and he was waiting for his girlfriend. He had quite a lot, but he now waited for a particular one. But he was late, and the girl already left. In Hungary, they are somehow not so patient. And then we met, and he asked me that what I am doing, and I explained him in quite detailed way. And then he said that if I have no better idea, then I should try to get to the university and study mathematics and physics. And at that time, we started as mathematical physics teachers in the first 2 years. And only after that, in the third year, you could choose. So out of 200, they did choose 20 who became mathematicians. The remaining studied physics and pedagogy, and how you call it in English anyway. So they became teachers. And we became mathematicians after 3 years. So it altogether took 5 years. And the next year, they already started as a mathematician, so they changed the system. So we lost a lot of time. So our mathematical education was not really as good as that time. So in Hungary, in the high school, in a very special high school, the mathematics is really taught in an extremely high level. So if you consider all these now so-called superstars in the Hungarian mathematics, almost all came from one high school in Fazekas, which is in Budapest. In Szeged and in Győr also there, and in Debrecen, which are mid-sized towns, there were also good high schools which specialized on mathematics, but Fazekas was by far the best. So I went there, and then I saw some of these guys, and I was scared to the death because they really knew a lot. In the second year, we were extremely lucky. Still, as a mathematical and physical teacher, we studied both mathematics and physics, but in mathematics, in the second year, Professor Paul Turán, who is my god, gave lectures for two seminars about number theory, and it included a lot of material, and he was extremely good lecturer. So, and of course, a great mathematician, although everybody knows him. And then I decided that maybe this is a nice subject, and then I will try to become a mathematician, at least to be chosen among these 20 people. That is very hard to, no, not so hard, because if we just consider like working on mathematics, because I didn't have the right education, so I moved toward the so-called combinatorics and graph theory, which at that time was not, I am almost sure, not considered to be part of mathematics. Definitely, it had, the other mathematician had a quite low opinion about combinatorics. Fortunately, it changed now, thanks to the computers, because for the computers, you, of course, need algorithms and a lot of mathematics. And the algorithms, of course, you can only write if you really know a lot of mathematics. So now, and then it's combinatorial, it's finite. So discrete mathematics became now a more recognized area of mathematics. But for me, at the very beginning, it was Paul Erdős. We worked together. One of my friends introduced me to him, and then we started to work together. He had an infinite amount of conjectures, problems, and they didn't require too much knowledge. So you could start to work on these problems, and sometimes you could solve it. So it's not like, yes, this high-quality mathematics, like, let's say, algebraic geometry, then you have to learn a lot, and then after you really know a lot, then most probably you start to work on problems and then on theory and so on. But in graphs and combinatorics, at that time at least, it was different. Not nowadays. Nowadays now you really have to know a lot, for, even for discrete mathematics. So now in discrete mathematics, we use continuous methods and vice versa. In continuous mathematics, now they start to use combinatorial ideas, discrete, which are taken from discrete mathematics. Once I sit in a class as a student, though I was already something like 60, of course it's, you never can say that somebody is the best, but he was definitely among the very best number theorists, and then he gave a lecture about a very, very nice and fundamental result, and I didn't know a lot, I didn't understand all, because I didn't have the necessary background. By that time, I had some background from analytic number theory, but not all. So I understood his talk, at least the message, but not in detail. For instance, I couldn't pass an exam about this theory. If I was asked in an exam, most probably I would fail. But close to the very end, then he said, okay, now it comes the punchline. And all the other things, let's just say it is just routine. It was, of course, not routine. There were many nice ideas. But for him, of course, it was routine. He's a great analytic number theorist. And then I realized that what he really considered as a punchline and the novel idea in the whole thing, actually this was a very simple combinatorial idea. So if you just gave this problem to a combinatorist, most probably would have solved it pretty fast. But only if you put out of the context and gave it as a combinatorial problem, forget about the other things. Of course, combinatorists without the background couldn't have proved the theorems which he was talking about. So now many, many even analysts start to realize that sometimes at the very heart of their proof there is a combinatorics, or at least combinatorial kind of reasoning, which is of course very hard to define what it means, and combinatorial kind of reasoning, but more or less we understand what it is. Paul Erdős was a very interesting guy. It was not hard, but not easy to meet him because he traveled all the time. So you had to catch him. But at that time, he came to Budapest quite often. It was in the 60s, like 65. And then he sit in the, of course, in the room of the director of the Rényi Institute of the Hungarian Academy of Science. It's a very nice institute because, before the Second World War, very rich people owned this house, and then it's still beautiful. And then, of course, the room of the director was. It was just, even if you didn't do anything, just you sit there, it was already, your day was all right. But he liked to talk to young mathematicians, or to be a mathematician, and I, at that time I was young. And then, because I also saw that the only way I can do mathematics is to combinatorics, due to my lack of knowledge, I was very happy to talk to him. And then he started to give problems, and then we then worked together. At the very beginning with Professor Sárközi, who much earlier joined Erdős, 2 years earlier, although he is younger than me, but because of my prehistory, I entered the university much later. So then we three of us worked together, and then later I worked with Paul Erdős, and that was the beginning. But later I worked with others. At the very beginning, two or three papers we wrote later too, but mainly it was concentrated, our joint work was concentrated at the beginning of my so-called career. Everybody says that Erdős Turán's conjectural arithmetic progression, and it might be true. I cannot be the judge. Definitely, this is not the one which I like the most. But people say that this was the most important result of mine. And I don't quarrel. I never quarrel with the mathematicians. They are just too clever. Or at least, of course, they have this strong the held belief. And they are pretty clever in average at least. It was a very nice theorem, and also it's very strange, though I already explained it some other time, then how it happened, and I started to work on this problem. It seems to be that by chance I get to something, yes, from factory to university, and then and so on. So I could give you 10 different examples, and when it was not clear then why I ended up like that. But I worked on some other problem, which I consider to be important, that is by my judgment. Maybe others would have a different opinion, but I like that problem very much. And then I solved this, and then I was, of course, when you are young and you solve something and you don't know too much, and then Erdős, of course, was the another god beside Paul Turán. I was very proud to show him the solution. But there was some problem with the solution. Then I proved in a theorem which was already proved by Euler, which was about 300 years ago. So it happens sometimes, yes. The mathematician proves theorems which others proved, but not 300 years ago. I should have known And another one, then I assume something, I even told the others that it should be trivial. Trivial means that easy. And then I put together these two things, the so-called trivial theorem, and then now we can call it Euler's theorem. Though Euler had 1,000 others, and obviously this was not his most, it was just a very small work of his. I put together these two so-called theorems. But then Professor Erdős told me, you rediscovered Euler's, you are younger, undereducated, that's fine, I can live with it. But there is a bigger problem than the second theorem is not proved. Nobody proved the second part, which was about that an arithmetic progress, that if you have a set of positive density, then it contains a four-term arithmetic progression. And it was not proved, only for three. And this was Rhodes' great result from the 50s. Then if you have positive density, a set of positive density, then it contains a three-term, but not four-term arithmetic progression. So I assumed something which was not proved. Actually, not only assumed, but I saw that it was an easy exercise. And then, after that, it is a very shameful experience, right? So then I started to work on this problem. So by choosing a wrong problem and giving a so-called solution to it, led me to start to work on this problem, instead of just directly starting. Because Erdős was there, he could have asked me to work on this problem. In graph theory, I usually work on extremal graph theory, which means that, for instance, you want to see that how many edges a graph must have to have some configuration. And this configuration could be different. And that is a very big area of graph theory, the extremal graph theory. So I quite extensively worked on this with some success, but of course with a lot of failure too. And then in computer science, by chance again, I started to work on computer science because I was invited to Stanford to the computer science department. So I have never, though I never worked on computer science, but one of my friends, Ron Graham, arranged the invitation, who was a combinatorist mainly. So I went there and then I heard some problems and then algorithmical problem and started to work on it. And when I came back to Hungary with my friends Miklós Ajtai and János Komlós, we started to work on their problems. And then solved some of them, which are now, some of them are in textbooks. But maybe the textbook is not good enough, so I don't know. Well, I don't know, they are wrong. Because I just see, I am doing the same thing as almost all the other mathematicians. Nothing irregular is about that. But of course, I take the problem, work on it, meditate on it. If I cannot do it, then I read some papers, hoping that I find something which I can connect. It's a regular way to do things. So of course, it is very, if you want to, well, maybe was some poet who wrote it, an irregular mind. Well, instead of irregular, he could have used some other stronger characterization. And at home, sometimes my family uses, so they don't say that I have an irregular mind, they say something else. So I don't feel that I have an irregular mind. I just have I like mathematics and I do mathematics, but nothing irregular about that. Here is a conference, and there are, I guess, 60 people. I don't know exactly how many mathematics on a very well-defined subject. They are just working and doing mathematics. Nothing irregular about it. Maybe people think that being mathematician is irregular, but it is not. Well, there are different professions, but mathematics is just one of them. It depends what you mean by imagination. Actually, I have an imagination about how to play soccer. Actually, my dream is somehow to get a phone call and asking me to be a manager of maybe Barcelona or Real Madrid, because I am expert on soccer. I watch soccer, I analyze. When I was young, I played soccer, but I was very short, so when they put me into different age group, then I couldn't physically, I was not strong enough. So imagination, yes, well, you can imagine a lot of things. Well, all of the mathematicians must have imagination. I don't quite understand. It is absolutely not specific for me. I am not the one who only has imagination. All of them have imagination. Without imagination, I have no idea how they could prove all these nice theorems which we heard in this conference. Well, extraordinary. Well, in an imagination, which actually is about just the high school material, you cannot solve hard problems, but many mathematicians have the same imagination. So I don't think so that I am very special about in this regard. But of course, you have to always write at the back of the book something, right? So that is why they wrote these things. Actually, I protested, but nobody listened to me. I just don't have enough power to. And then they worked a lot, the editors, so they were nice, so I really didn't want to insist too long. So now it is there, but it is misleading. It's getting renewed interest right now, because now it is connected to many branches of mathematics. At the very beginning, of course, as it always happens, just baby theorems, but then it started more and more complicated. People realized to prove, like in this conference, a lot of course, it's the half of the talks are about combinatorial analysis. That is now official name, combinatorial analysis. In other words, they already added analysis, not just combinatorial. And later it became much more complicated, and great mathematicians like just Tao and Burgen, they are the absolutely top mathematicians, work on this subject, and then they really find a lot of connection with the other areas, and not only, but then using methods and theorem for combinatorial analysis, they prove something quite often which is beyond the tools of recent mathematics, like Burgen could estimate exponential sums, which was impossible by the usual analytic number theoretical methods. So, and then many times it happened, and this theorem are applied even in I am not sure in physics, but it means, but definitely in computer science. It's all over in computer science. And in analysis, they also use. So it just happened in the last 20 years. Most probably before that, it still, of course, it existed. But now it just is a sudden revolution. But it's a little bit strong word, but that is what happened.